I think we're about ready to get started. All right, so welcome everybody to today's Maker Talk. We're going to be talking about Indigo Dye with Jack Saltmoon. You can see Jack waving there. Jack's pronouns are they, them. And if you want to just see nothing on the screen but Jack, you can hover over Jack's picture and you will see three little dots. And when you hit those three little dots, there'll be a drop-down menu that says pin. And then you can pin it so that Jack is the main person that you see. So yeah, and I think that's about it. So Jack, I'm gonna let you take it away from here.
Thanks so much. Hi everyone. This is my first time giving a talk or lecture like this. So thank you all so much for being here and for trusting me with your time. I really hope that you find this interesting and engaging. I am a textile artist. I create clothing, tapestry, weavings, yarn, and accessories in addition to raw fabric using natural dyes. Most of what I want to talk about today is indigo, but we're going to start with a few sort of an overview of natural dyeing generally as an art with a little bit of history and some examples of different kinds of dye and how modern artists use them. So I started learning about natural dyes in my teens because I was interested in historical reenactment and living history education. Pre-industrial clothing manufacturing techniques were really interesting to me because people always seem to have had an interest in expressing themselves through color, regardless of their place, their time in history, or their social or economic class. Basically, since we've had communities, like since the Stone Age, we've had evidence of dyed textiles using everything from earth pigments like ochre to all the way up through the invention of synthetic dyes in the 1800s. I am going to show you today some natural dyes that are basically unchanged from over the last 6,000 years. We're using some of the same materials that have been found at Stone Age sites in Europe and North Africa. And I'm really drawn to the way that natural dyes create colors that aren't static, they evolve. And the way that the colors that come from plants can be affected by a variety of different factors like soil pH, the amount of rain that the plants get in a given year, the temperature and the harvest season. And I really enjoy the way that dyeing with my own plants, as I've started to grow them myself, connects me to my environment and involves me in more of the process of making my own garments. The last favorite thing about what I do is that everything that I make with natural dyes is unique. Even with the time-tested recipes that I have learned from other dye artists, nothing is precisely replicable. So every time I create something is a new experience. And so the piece of art is unique and ephemeral. And I love that for my own clothes. And I love being able to share that with the people who I give my work to. So I want to talk a little bit about why we choose the specific dyes that we do. There are five basic important factors in choosing natural dyes for modern textile artists. Light fastness, meaning how well it holds up to being exposed to usually ultraviolet light, sunlight. Wash fastness, or how well it holds up to sweat and exposure to soap and water. sustainability and ethics, including how much human exploitation is in, and environmental damage is involved in the harvesting of the raw materials for dyeing, safety for people harvesting, processing, dyeing with it and wearing it, and consistency, which is how well the dye reliably reproduces similar color results on properly prepared fabrics. Most natural dyes lack at least one of these qualities. Things like berries and avocado skins, or turmeric that you might have experimented with in your own kitchen as an adult or as a kid, give really bright, beautiful colors, but they're highly fugitive. A fugitive dye is a dye that is not fast. It doesn't hold up to sunlight or washing. Other dyes that are popular, like Brazilian logwood, which makes a very bright, beautiful purple, is very popular, but its harvesting is a contributor to Amazonian deforestation. It's not just used for natural dyeing, it's also used for making contrast solution for medical purposes. Blacks and greens that have been used, that have been made in the past with iron and copper powders are very toxic. And colors made with flowers like coreopsis or hollyhocks that I've grown myself can be very fast, but also very unpredictable. So it's difficult for other artists to reproduce the colors. So the reason why I tell you all of this is because most dyers these days work with a particular set of sort of core dyes that have reliable results and are safe to work with, that produce a particular set of colors that we use. We use madder for red and orange, weld for yellow, indigo for blue, walnut for black, and cochineal for fuchsia and violet. So I'm going to show you some examples of some pieces that I've made with these different materials. And then we can talk a little bit about the ways that dyes are fixed to the fabrics. The opener for the rainbow here of core dyes is madder. Madder is the root of a sort of a weed from the Middle East. It's one of the oldest natural dyes that we have after earth pigments. It creates a beautiful, vibrant red. It can also be used to make deep burgundies and bright oranges, depending on the pH of the solution. This piece of silk here was dyed with two different materials. The yellow background color is weld, which is a plant that grows wild in Northern Europe. The tops and the leaves are used to make different shades of bright yellow, usually like a bright chrome yellow, all the way through this very soft butter yellow. And then this leaf pattern here is eco printing with eucalyptus. So what happens here is the leaves are wrapped up in the silk and then steamed for multiple hours. The eucalyptus leaves a print on the fabric that is permanent. Next we have indigo, which I'm going to be spending most of my time talking about today. Indigo is an unusual dye for a few reasons. It is unique in that it is a plant that is one of the handful of plants that bear the only natural source of blue. The compound is called indigotin. Indigo is native to India, but there are blues in other places, Northern European woad, which you may have heard of, Elu in West Africa, and knotweed in Japan, all carry the same compound, but in smaller quantities. Indigo has been shipped all over the world, and different varieties are now endemic to different countries. So these different dyes can be mixed or layered over each other. Here I have an example of a green and blue piece that was made by dyeing a gradient of indigo onto this bag and then dyeing weld the yellow over top of it. It's difficult to mix dyes, but they can be layered pretty effectively. And the last couple of examples that I want to show you are cochineal. Cochineal is a small insect native to Peru that feeds on paddle cactus, and it produces these beautiful like fuchsia and violet colors, again, dependent on the pH of the dye bath. I'm showing you most of these on silk because silk is very vibrant and works well on camera. But the reason why these are all natural textiles is because natural dyes don't take on synthetics. You can't dye polyester. Interestingly, you can dye textiles like rayon and tencel, which people think of as synthetics, but they're actually cellulose. They're plant fibers that have been cooked down and spun out back into fibers that can be made into textiles. I really like working with rayon and tencel, especially because they're very affordable and they're quite sustainable. Rayon and tencel are usually made with bamboo, which can be easily farmed. I'm going to put these aside for just a second. And so I want to talk about how natural dyes work on a chemical level. Most natural dyes, with a couple of important exceptions that we're going to talk about later, have to be fixed to the fibers that they're on by treating the textile before dyeing with a solution called a mordant. Most common mordants like alum, aluminum sulfate, are safe to handle in home dye quantities, but a lot of mineral alum isn't produced sustainably. And mordants like chrome and copper sulfate and ferrous sulfate are hazardous to handle and can pollute water tables in large amounts. So I still use mineral alum for some of my projects, and it's great for beginners because it's consistent, but these days I prefer to work around it if I can. Dyeing fabric without the environmental and health hazards of some of these mordants can be done in a few ways. You can use simplicose leaves. Simplicose is a tree that is native to Indonesia. It absorbs aluminum from the groundwater, which can help create healthier soil in polluted areas. So simplicose is popular to plant along rivers to help clean the water and the soil. So the alum collects in the leaves, and then when the fallen leaves are harvested, they can be cooked down and used as a sustainable mordant for making very bright colors. You can use scrap metal mordants. Let me show you. So here, I know this looks very gross, but I've made a solution using old rusty nails and vinegar. This is called iron liquor for dyeing. If you soak your fabric in it before dyeing, it creates very strong, dark colors. You can also wrap fabric around scrap metal, like old pipe, or bundle up cans or, again, rusty nails inside your fabric to create sort of abstract patterns. Or you can dye in old pots that have trace amounts of copper or iron in them that will release when they're heated. And those will add a small amount of mordant to the dye bath. You can use tannins, which are extracted from materials like bark or tea, oak leaves, or one of my favorites is avocado pits. You can, because I can keep them in the freezer. So you heat them and soak them, and you have a tannin solution that you can soak your fabric in before dyeing. Dyeing over tannins makes these very soft, deep earth tones. Or you can use my favorite technique, which is dyeing with dyes that don't require a mordant at all. The most common and important of these is indigo, but eucalyptus leaves, like I showed you on the weld silk, make a gold, peach, or red dye that doesn't require a mordant and is extremely fast. Eucalyptus is generally sustainably harvested, and it's an invasive species in some areas, so people will pay you to take it away. My brother sends me eucalyptus from California. I have gotten it from weddings, from floral arrangements. It's an easy material to use, and it's highly sustainable. So most of what I want to talk about today is indigo. So I'm going to show you a little bit about how indigo works first on a chemical level, and then we'll talk a little bit about the history of the dye, and then I will demonstrate some more advanced indigo dyeing techniques. Okay, so here is a little miniature indigo vat. And I know what you're gonna say, and we're gonna get there. This mini vat is so that I can show you what's going on underneath the surface of the vat. Indigo is different than other dyes for a few interesting reasons. So the first thing that I'm sure that you've noticed is that this is not actually blue at all. There's a little bit of blue scum here on the top, but you see it's this weird like green red color. That's because so when I create a vat, I mix powdered indigo. This indigo is from a farming cooperative in the Carolinas. As you can see, it's this deep blue, almost black. Actually, it looks black on camera, but it's a very, very deep blue. So I mix dried and powdered indigo leaves with water. But the interesting part is that indigo is not actually water soluble. So I have to turn it into a dye that will mix with water and soak into fibers, I have to mix it with other chemicals. So I use calcium hydroxide, which is pickling lime. It's used to make corn masa, for instance, and fructose, which is just fruit sugar. And these react with each other to remove oxygen from the solution that has the indigo in it. In this process, the chemicals break oxygen off of the indigo molecules themselves, and that makes them water soluble. The interesting part is that once the indigo is water soluble, it's no longer blue. I want to show you, move our camera down here. I want to show you how this reaction works. So I'm going to, I've got a piece of linen here. Linen is one of my favorite textiles to dye along with rayon because it's very sturdy and very washable, unlike silk. So I'm gonna wet that down. I have a lot of liquids here on my table, if everyone will bear with me. And I'm gonna add it to my indigo vat. So in doing this, I'm taking care not to introduce too much oxygen into the solution by disturbing the surface. So I move this around gently in a larger vat, like the one that I am going to work with later, or the 20 gallon that I have outside in my backyard. I would do this with my hands, but I'm just using a spoon. So the more I move it around, the more indigo it attracts, and the longer I leave it, the darker the color will be. So I'm gonna just sort of drape this over the edge here for a minute while I talk to you about different kinds of indigo vats so that we can give this some time to set. So there are three different primary kinds of indigo vats that different artists use. They all rely on the same principle of oxygen reduction in a solution, and they have benefits and drawbacks. Iron-based vats yield very, very strong colors very quickly, and they only take a few minutes of setup, but they're very caustic. They're not safe or comfortable for you to put your hands into, like I like to when I work. They can be hazardous to dispose of. The iron sediment can be a pollutant. And the iron can damage very delicate fibers like wool or silk. Fermentation vats, which if you are a person who's interested in natural dyes, you may have heard of as the way that indigo works. They use wheat bran and sodium carbonate, just, you know, washing soda or soda ash, are very, very gentle and very safe. They're great for super delicate textiles, but they can be pretty tricky to set up, and they take about a week to turn on, as I say. My preferred vat is what's usually called a sugar vat. And I think that it balances the two considerations, the intense colors and the safety and ease of use and setup. It uses very simple ingredient proportions and only takes about 2 hours to settle into a useful vat. I also really like it because it's easy and comfortable for me to put my hands into. I can, you know, on a day when I die, I will spend a large portion of the day with my arms in the solution. And I like that the sugar vat isn't dangerous or bad for my skin or anything like that. So all of these different vat styles, like I said, have the same goal. They remove oxygen from the solution to make indigo water soluble. So here's how we get the color back. So I'm hoping that we can see this. All right. So I'm going to pull this out of the vat now, and I want you to take a look at the color that the fabric is when it comes out. So as you can see, it's not blue at all right now. We've got a little strip near the top that's blue, but it's this weird yellow-green color. But you can see, you might be able to see here now, that it's changing colors a little bit. This process is slow. I'm going to speed it up with some water. But what's happening here is that when indigo is exposed to oxygen again, the indigo molecules bond with oxygen and they turn blue again. So it's a sort of a turquoise color right now. If we let this sit, which I'm going to, you'll be able to continue to watch it as it turns a deeper and now, oh yeah, now it's really going. As it turns a deeper and deeper shade of blue. I find this process to be so fascinating. The more times you dip and re-oxygenate your fabric, the deeper the blue will be. It works most effective when you let the dye set completely before rinsing it, then let the piece dry and then dip again, which means that finishing a piece, if I'm trying to get like a deep cobalt blue or a navy blue, like, sorry, that's taking just a second. So like this, like the top of the sling here, this deep color took about 3 days for me to get this depth. The more dips you do, the darker it gets, but the effect is less and less intense with each dip. So when I am done with with an indigo piece, when I've reached the color that I want it to be, I boil it in a solution of water and vinegar for about 15 minutes, and that neutralizes the alkalinity of the indigo vat and gets rid of any sediment that might be there, and that's the process for the basic process for making these pieces. Yeah, so as you can see, we have a true blue now. If I boiled this, it would become, in vinegar, it would become even bluer because right now it has some of the metallic sediment from the vat still on it. So I'm going to take a short break from demos here for just a few minutes, and I want to talk about, sorry, I'm going to rinse my hands so that I don't get indigo all over my computer. I want to talk about the history of indigo. I'm interested in indigo's history because it has experienced a revival recently, since the 1970s. And indigo has a fascinating legacy that's tied to colonialism and imperialism in South Asia and the Americas. So because the dye that's extracted from indigo was very rare and expensive, it was a symbol of status and wealth in Europe. In 1747, the first shipment of indigo from the Americas arrived in England, and within about 2 decades, more than 1 million pounds would be shipped to England every year. Indigo was South Carolina's largest export, second only to rice, in the 50 years leading up to the Civil War. Indigo production was extremely labor intensive and a very highly skilled process that was carried out almost exclusively by enslaved people. To capitalize on indigo's commercial success, white landowners farming indigo imported enslaved people from Africa at a much, much higher rate than those farming other crops, which resulted in a spike that eventually led to enslaved people outnumbering free white people nearly 2-to-1 in indigo producing states like Georgia, the Carolinas, and Tennessee. In India and Bangladesh at the same time, British imperialists and their commercial agents were carrying out a similar massive forced labor campaign for the industrial production of indigo, which had been cultivated in South Asia for about 6,000 years. These indigo workers eventually organized the first of many indigo revolts in 1857, beginning in Bengal, but eventually spreading to much of northern India against the inhumane conditions imposed by the British, including bans on growing their own food crops in an effort to maximize dye production. So these revolts in combination with the end of the Civil War and subsequent collapse of the slave-powered production of indigo in southern states, resulted in an intense strain on the global indigo market. This resolved in 1897 when a German chemical company developed the means to manufacture synthetic indigo on an industrial scale. Production of natural indigo all but disappeared at that point. The trouble is that synthetic indigo comes with substantial environmental hazards. It's petroleum-based, and using it requires a mordant, unlike natural indigo. The mordant that is used for synthetic indigo releases large amounts of cyanide and formaldehyde into wastewater. In addition to excess insoluble blue pigment that reduces the amount of light and oxygen that in the rivers where the wastewater is released. This can result in algae blooms and the death of wildlife species. Synthetic indigo is used primarily for denim, and it's the largest source of waterway pollution in the world. Modern indigo farmers are trying to address both the environmental costs of synthetic indigo and the history of oppression and violence in the name of natural dye. So in the last 20 years, organizations in South Carolina, Tennessee, and Bangladesh have been innovators in sustainable indigo production in the modern era. So in the American South, Stony Creek Colors pays and trains tobacco farmers to switch to indigo. Tobacco is a soil depleter, and indigo is a nitrogen-rich plant that composts very well and actually enriches the soil that it grows in. And in Bangladesh, the Living Blue Dye Collective manages their own ethical production of indigo and indigo-dyed cotton. I think that the work of these two groups is absolutely essential in keeping indigo connected to self-determination for the people that grow it and die with it, and the health for the land that they grow it on. So I'm gonna take you over to my studio space now for just a few minutes and show you some of my equipment and talk a little bit about some of the techniques that I use to do more advanced dye styles with indigo. I'm gonna move my computer around so nobody freak out. Welcome to my kitchen. We're okay. All right, so this is the space that I do most of my small projects in. I have a large 20-gallon indigo vat that I think I mentioned earlier outside, but most of what I do is done in the 5-gallon vat that you see right here. Indigo is the dye that is most commonly used for a technique called shibori that I'm sure many of you have heard of. The word comes from the Japanese for pressing or squeezing. The technique actually developed independently in a number of different places. It's called adire in West Africa and amaras in Peru. So for clarity, I will use the term shibori when I am talking about specific techniques made popular by Japanese artists, and resist dyeing or indigo resist when I'm talking more generally. So I'm going to show you a little bit of my equipment and give you a demonstration of one of the resist techniques that I like to use to give you an idea of the kinds of things that you can create with indigo. After that, I'm going to hand it over to you guys for Q&A, okay? This is gonna take a few minutes for me to set up, but you get to watch the whole process. Okay.
So the technique that I want to demonstrate for you today is called arashi. Arashi shibori means storm. And the technique is supposed to mimic the appearance of rushing water or leaves in rain. It's an organic pattern as opposed to some of the more geometric styles that I can create using my resist tools. I can create a variety of different patterns using tools like wooden circles, clothespins. All of these things are have been in the Indigo pot many times. But today I'm going to use the pole wrapping technique for arashi. I'm going to set that up right here in front of you guys. So I have some silk that has been soaking. It's important to start with wet fibers so that they don't expand excessively when you start with them. So I'm going to take my piece and wrap it around my goal here. And the effect that you get depends strongly on how you choose to wrap or tie your piece. I'm going to use some cotton cord. To add tension to my design. I hope you all will bear with me while I do this. Sorry, got some tangles. So the cord keeps indigo dye off of any place that it touches. Once I'm done wrapping the cord around my piece. Just a second. I'm going to tie it off the top. And then we're going to add some additional pleating to change the shape of the pattern that we create. So I'm going to press this together very tightly to create these sort of organic pleats. And then we're going to add it very gently to my 5-gallon vat. This reaction works best if the liquid is warm. So for working outside in cold weather, I have a water heater. Some of you might recognize this. It's actually a livestock trough heater, and it keeps the water at a temperature that is above freezing, but is comfortable for me to hit the my hands in, it won't boil anything. So I'm gonna put my hands in and move the fabric around gently to distribute as much of the indigo as I can. And ordinarily for a first dip for a piece, I would leave this in for 15 to 20 minutes. The reaction can begin to reverse itself. The indigo can reproduce off of the textile if you leave it in for a very long period of time. Generally, I've found that that doesn't start to happen for 2 to 3 hours. But for the sake of our demonstration, I'm going to pull this out now so that you can see what our result is. So you can see we've already started to turn a little bit blue here. I'm going to collect the drips in a bowl that I can return back to the vat layer. And I push this down and rinse it to reoxygenate it. So I don't want to untie this until after the reaction has made some progress. So I'm gonna let this drip here while I take some questions from Q&A. And then when we have just a couple minutes left, I will untie this so you can see what our results are, okay? Molly, I think we can get started on Q&A. I'm gonna pull up our chat and
awesome. Yeah, we got a lot of questions.
Yeah, that's what I'm seeing. So, thank you all so much.
Yeah. Let me scroll back and look at the very, very beginning. Some of these questions you didn't answer. Yeah, get some water. Yeah. And I will find the questions from people. Okay. First question is from Robin Wolfson. If I want to grow my own indigo, which genus species is best and where is best to purchase it from?
Okay, so if you want to grow your own indigo, there are a few different varieties. I get my indigo, I don't grow indigo myself, but I know some people who do. I get most of my indigo from Stony Creek Colors. They sell both indigo seeds and powdered indigo. They're headquartered in Tennessee. I like to use plant varieties that are either native or endemic to my local area. And I believe that they use an indigo variety that is native to South Asia. You may also find indigo seeds from Japan, which will give you a lighter color and maybe less hardy, or from Peru. Any indigo variety that's from the Americas is probably going to do decently well. You can harvest indigo the first or second year, and you can dye with it fresh or dried. I would definitely recommend Stony Creek Colors for local indigo seeds.
Yeah. Let's see. Annette Ambivert asked, do these dyes work on both cellulose and protein, or are some just for one material?
So most natural dyes take a little bit better on protein, so that's silk and wool, than cellulose. I use a lot of cellulose personally because cellulose textiles like linen or rayon are very resilient and easy to wash. So they're practical for other people to wear and use in their daily lives. The easiest way to get, sorry, I'm going to show you, I'm going to show you a few of my materials. The easiest way to get cellulose textiles to take natural dyes other than indigo, indigo works equally well on both cellulose and protein fibers, is to use a mordant called aluminum acetate. It has a strong vinegar smell, so it can be a little bit scary to use if you're a beginner, and it's very powdery, so I usually wear a mask when I use it, but it's very safe to actually physically handle. It's a very, very mild acid, and it essentially is just breaking down the surface of the cellulose to allow the dye to adhere to it. I like to use indigo for a lot of my projects, partially because it performs equally well on cellulose and protein.
Okay. We have a question about walnut dye from Allison Sheedy.
Yeah.
Do you have tips for creating shibori-type patterns using natural dyes that require heat, like walnut hulls, for long periods of time? I have not been able to maintain nice white parts using this method.
That is challenging. So my recommendation would be to mix iron and tannin. These two things react with each other to produce a fairly intense dark color. So I would treat your material with tannins first. Tannins that don't necessarily impart like a very dark color. Then do your shibori pleating or wrapping, and then soak in an iron solution like the one that I showed you in the jar that I have. You won't get bright white parts, but the iron will react very quickly with the tannins. So you should get sharp, clear lines between the tannin and the iron and tannin layers.
Anna Woodbury asked, this might be a really weird question, but do any of these dyes make the fabric more flammable?
That's not a weird question. I have a lot of people who are concerned about, for instance, using these dyes for children's clothing or bedding. And no, they do not make your materials more flammable. I will say that eucalyptus has pigmented oils in it that I have not tested the flammability of, but is not something that I would, but eucalyptus oil being mildly flammable is not something that I would rule out. But the core dyes, indigo, cochineal, weld, walnut, and madder do not make textiles more flammable.
Okay. I feel slightly disappointed, but I'm also glad at the same time. Let's see. Catherine Anderson asked, do you have any favorite online resources for new ideas, especially pattern ideas or book resources?
Oh, yes. I read the weekly dye discussion by Botanical Colors every week that usually features questions by established dyers. I follow the links and look at their work to inspire me. I also like to research who's teaching workshops and classes in a given time period. Even if I can't attend them, I can take a look at their work and see what's popular. It's easy to follow Instagram hashtags for indigo, shibori, or natural dye. I also have, hang on.
You can see the change in color on the pole dye as well.
A variety of texts on natural dye, especially shibori, that one of my favorites of which was recently translated from Japanese. So it has a lot of techniques that are not as familiar to Western shibori artists. So I get to experiment with things that I haven't seen other popular artists do. I also get a lot of inspiration from the sky, the water, anything blue. I like to take photographs and run them through different filters on my phone and things like that to give me inspiration for organic patterns or moods that I want to create with my textiles.
That's really cool. Annette Ambivert asked, what maintenance does a vat of this style need? I assume it's the one sitting behind you, the 5-gallon vat.
So one of the nice things about this style of indigo vat is that it can be maintained with very little effort for a very long time. If I turn this, you can see that I have written the date that I made it on it. Is that August or September? that's July. Yep.
Yes.
So I made this on July 14th. And it's still very functional. Indigo vats need to be re-reduced as they're used. So I can add, so after I use it heavily for like a large project, I stir it a little bit. I add a little bit of fructose, fruit sugar to it, then seal it back up with its lid and just leave it be. I have had one of these vats last for 8 months, I think. And my outdoor vat lasted over the entire winter last year, and only needed about a day of sort of recharge time when I rebalanced it in the spring.
Wow. Would you say it's a relatively low maintenance dye?
Indigo is labor intensive in sort of in the immediate sense, but there are indigo vats that have been, like, individual indigo vats that have been maintained and sort of refed and refueled for literally hundreds of years in North Africa.
That's wild.
Yeah, it's pretty cool.
Awesome. Another indigo vat question from Carmen Teresa. What did you put in your studio indigo vat? I would like to know in case I decide to do this. Well, I assume that's the bigger one by the studio indigo vat. Please type something to let me know.
So all of the vats are the same ingredients. They are just my, hang on. Oh, no, I brought it over. Okay. They're just my Stony Creek Colors indigo powder in one part. The important part is the proportions. The actual amounts in terms of measurements are not that important. So one part powdered indigo, two parts calcium hydroxide, that's the lime, the alkaline powder that's used to, like, that's used to break down corn and other grains. And then three parts fruit sugar. If this were a fermentation vat, you'd be using, like, you can use pears or apples that have the same sugars in them that will react with the indigo. And so all of my vats use these same proportions and ingredients, just in different amounts based on the intensity of color I'm looking for a particular project, or how large the vat is.
We have one final question. What is the weirdest dye you have ever heard of?
Oh, man.
Because you talked about the bug dye, and that was pretty...
the bug dye is pretty weird. I can show you guys the...
Oh, do you have... Does it come
I have a tiny bit of... It's already been processed, so it no longer looks like bugs. But this is cochineal.
It has an odd smell that is distinctly organic, let's say. But I have also worked with bugs that have not been quite so thoroughly processed. You can use a coffee grinder or something to break them down a little bit more. I've heard of some very misguided dyes. I'm aware of people who have made inks and dyes using cigarette butts for specific projects, which are obviously very toxic. I'm aware of thistle and nettle being used to make some lovely greens, but they're very hard on the skin, let's say. And I myself made one of my first dye projects was making dye with hollyhocks that I had grown myself. I've never been able to quite reproduce the color that I made with them. It was a teal or turquoise color. Not necessarily a weird dye, but a very odd result, which is the kind of thing that's pretty common when you're using more experimental dyes.
What color do hollyhocks normally do?
Hollyhocks, like a lot of flowers, don't usually yield a very strong color, but most of the results that I've seen other people get from them have been shades of light to medium purple or like a soft gray. I got deep purples, a very deep pine green. First time I got this, all the questions that we have, I want to untie our little shibori experiment here. Probably not going to be super dramatic given that the short period of time that we did the dip for, but I'm just going to unwind this so that you all can see the effect that we get. If any of you are interested, there are some great books on shibori techniques available from Botanical Colors online. Michelle Garcia also has some fantastic videos on creating designs with shibori. And you can always contact me. I am I'm tagged in the original listing for this talk. So you can always contact me with questions that you have about dye techniques or how to experiment with dyes yourself. Or projects that you might have in mind. I'm more than happy to share my experiences and help you get started with your own projects. So you can see up here sort of a striped marbled effect. I'm going to grab one piece of linen that I have that...
Yeah. Sorry, I didn't get to everybody's questions. I had an internet drop for a couple seconds, but I seem to be back. So,
that uses the same technique, but with many, many more dips. These very, very dramatic stripes that look like water or like ice flows. The more care and time you put into smoothing your fabric, pleating everything carefully, maintaining even tension, and being patient with your dips, the more dramatic your results will be. Working with indigo especially has been a journey of learning patience and understanding that I'm not in control of a lot of things, but it's been very worth it. Are there any more questions?
I think we got two more if you got time.
Yeah, absolutely.
Let's see. We got a question from LS about walnut dye. Is walnut only for black, or can it make brown?
Walnut can make brown. It's usually used to make black in combination with iron or alum. But you can make browns with a very dilute walnut solution, or a very dilute dilute mordant with a walnut solution.
Okay. And then I think this is going to be our final question from Robin Wolfson. Yeah. How much water to the 1-2-3 proportions, and does soft versus hard water change anything?
So with indigo, soft versus hard water is not a major consideration. With other dyes, the pH absolutely affects the colors that you will get in some very interesting ways. Acids tend to make colors warmer. Alkaline water makes colors cooler. But with indigo, you are really just using the amount of liquid that you need to submerge your piece. The important thing is the weight of dye, of the dye itself, the weight of the, I put it away, the weight of the, like the powdered indigo, the actual dye stuff, to the weight of the amount of fiber that you plan to dye. So with my little bat that I had on the table, that's 2 tablespoons, about 25 grams of powdered indigo. And that's enough to dye about 1 pound of fiber, a light to medium blue. This vat uses a lot more water proportionally, but is only about twice as much indigo dye. It's the same vat that I used to make this color. So a fairly deep blue. The vat that I have outside is 20 gallons, but has roughly the same concentration of is sort of indigo to water. So of indigo to fiber, so that I can get fairly consistent colors. So the amount of water doesn't really matter as long as you can submerge your piece. You're weighing the amount of dye to the amount of fiber that you plan to dye.
I'm surprised that it's relatively a small amount of indigo dye for the vat that you have.
Yes, it's very, very, it's very potent.
Yeah. Okay. Well, thank you so much, Jack, for doing this talk.
Of course. Thank you all so much for coming. This was a really, really cool experience. And thank you so much, Molly, for setting this up.
Yeah. This is one of the more example heavy talks that we've done so far, and thank you so much for taking the time to go over the whole process and
of course
show us the dye live.